Yeah, welcome everybody to another meetup of the FinTech and InsurTech meetup. Today we host a meetup. It starts right now and we will maybe take until 8 o'clock. Yeah, maybe just talking quickly about the host while other people are still joining the meetup. First of all, maybe about me. So I'm Matthias from working my day job for ISG in the workplace space, so digital workplace for banks and insurance companies. And I'm also a host of this meetup, as also Lena is. Maybe Lena, you can introduce yourself a bit.
Hi everyone. I'm a former fintech founder and currently in a sabbatical looking for the next job to be joined by myself. And I'm co-hosting this event for, I think, the fifth time. Looking forward to tonight's topic.
And also, Jan is also one of our co-hosts. Hi, Jan.
Hello, here's Jan. I'm a co-founder of a web development agency from Cologne called Raiselove and contact tracing app Recover. And I'm also running one of the biggest fintech newsletters, fintechweekly.com, with over 20,000 subscribers worldwide.
Fantastic. And today's lineup, I would say, is that we first host a talk of Oliver, who is the CTO of Entity Data Germany, one of the biggest IT provider in the world, or Asia and Europe, I think. And he will talk about the role of the insurance companies in sustainability, how they can innovate, how they can manage their risk and so on. So I'm really interested in it, as I also work in consulting. And then we also host a panel with a lot of people from really good startups like Elena from Tomorrow and David from Ecolytic, and also Leslie from U Impact and his Ristan from the Novus Bank in the UK, I think. And we have also a bonus for you today, which is Eleanor, who just joined the lineup, I think 1 day ago. And she talks about the challenges what fintech companies have that are sustainable when doing marketing. So she will share her best learnings out of that in a very quick 50-minute talk. So I'm really curious about it as many new neobanks pop up. I think it's a crowded space and there's more segmentation. So I think the marketing in the fintech space becomes more and more important. Cool. And as you might have heard, the topic today is sustainable finance. You might have booked your summer vacation and you might have also bought your Bitcoin after the dip, but now let's talk about one of the biggest challenges we have in this and the upcoming decades, which is the climate change. And this is, from my perspective, not only affecting car companies or energy suppliers, but everybody has to do, all industries have to do their part when it comes to mitigating the effects of this climate change. And I also think there's a huge demand from the regulator and also from the consumers. So there's also a lot of business to make with that. For example, if you're a provider for services for banks, you can maybe help them to navigate the transformation. Or if you're a bank and want to offer a differentiation to other banks, you can offer people or help them to live a more sustainable life. So I think that's there's also a lot of money to make in the space from that transformation. So basically we start with insurance and then we head over to the banking and asset management space and discover what's going on there. And also Lena on LinkedIn provided a poll and people just she just asked the financial industry is the key to tackle climate change, and 38% said I agree. I think they just wanted to be nice to Lena. but also 26% they disagreed. So maybe we can convince also more people to agree today. So that would be a nice vote. And that the topic has traction, you can also see from money that is flowing into this ESG criteria-based assets. You can see clear growth in money that flows into these ESG-based assets. And I think it will continue. And also sustainable ETFs, for example, outperformed their not sustainable ETFs. And so there's also a sign that companies that take care about these ESG criterias, that they are also more successful.
So thank you for the introduction. Today, I would like to talk about the role of the insurer in the context of sustainability. And actually, there's quite a few things to discover, different roles that are relevant here, the innovator, the influencer, the investor, and of course, the risk manager, which is at the heart of the industry, of course. So as an agenda, I would first like to set the context a little bit. What do we understand under sustainability? And then dive into the different roles that were already shown in the title of this presentation. And we will start with innovator and influencer. We'll understand a little bit about stakeholders in the overall economy game and how insurers can play a role there. And then specifically look at the roles of the investor and the risk manager, and then come to a conclusion, maybe also with some ideas around what could startups do in that space. That could be interesting for the participants as well. And hopefully furnish the ground also a little bit for the upcoming panel discussion. A few words to NTT. You had already introduced us. We are a fairly large company. Little known fun fact, we invented the emoji. So probably you have all used one of our innovations already today. So happy customers of our innovation. We are a large company. That by itself is not the quality. I think you as startups would challenge us that quality is a size. Size is a quality. However, size is also a challenge, especially when talking about sustainability. We are running one of the biggest network infrastructures in the world. And we have also our own sustainability goals. So we also want to become carbon neutral. We have subscribed to the UN Sustainability Development Goals. And it's not that we advise clients only on how to become more advisable. We are also working very hard to become sustainable by ourselves. So kind of eat our own dog food. Our headquarters is in Japan. As the name suggests. And Japan has actually formed the notion of Society 5.0, which is fairly interesting. And there's actually a free book also from Springer that you can download on your Kindle for free, or you find it as a PDF that explains what Society 5.0 is all about, smart society, as the Japanese colleagues refer to it. And sustainability is really at the core of our Society 5.0. And maybe we can put a link to that book also in the show notes, because it's really interesting, showing the connection between technology and sustainability, which I think in the future will become most relevant for the survival of our planet. So let's talk about sustainability. In sustainability, you will always come across these three letters here, ESG. You probably have seen this already somewhere. Stands for environmental, social, and governance themes. What unites these themes is that they are not immediately shown in the balance sheet of your organization. So very often they were overlooked and deemed not so relevant. However, this has changed. We have seen the numbers in the introduction. More and more money is flowing into companies that adhere to these topics, or investments that specifically address these topics. These topics are really important. Matthias was specifically alluding to the environmental aspects. If I would have to choose a favorite, I mean, definitely environmental is critical for survival, but I always like to highlight also the social ones. That's fairly important for me, especially around health and safety and human rights. And not sure whether you are aware that you are actually owning slaves. You may have thought, oh, slavery was abolished a long time ago. But when you go to a nice site that is the slaveryfootprint.org, I've just updated my own slave workforce today, and I learned it's 75. So to support my lifestyle with a car, with an apartment in Munich, with quite a few electronic gadgets that have some fancy commodities baked in, and with my travel style, I have 75 slaves working for me. That's not so nice. And that's why I believe it's not only about the environment, it's also about us people. And the ESG goals are way more than just green. Green is, of course, important, but it goes beyond that. And yeah, feel free, there's a link at the bottom of the page to count your own slaves that you run. How do we approach this topic? Of course, we can have speeches about it, how bad the situation is, but that will not change anything. At the end, there's always policy needed, and policy helps us to enforce. Of course, policy needs to be formed. This is why we have elections and political parties and debates and so forth. But at the end, the outcome is a policy, and the policy has a very good impact because it's binding. So people need to stick to it, and then change will happen. And how does the change happen, especially in the area of sustainability? There's a nice graphic that the OECD put out that actually shows how impact is made. Impact is made initially by, of course, putting that policy on the table, but the policy itself also doesn't change anything. So the discussion doesn't change anything, the policy doesn't change anything. Where does the change come from? The change comes from innovation. It can be a social innovation, like we don't want to have slaves anymore, at least officially. But the innovation can also come from technology, like we put the catalyst in our car. So this innovation is then having the positive impact. But how can we make the innovation happen? And that requires financing, because innovation usually requires money. You need to change stuff that costs money. And that's why I believe strongly that the finance industry and also the insurance industry as a very large institutional investor are key for sustainability, because they are actually the engine, or rather the fuel you put into this transformation program. And so sustainable finance and also sustainable insurance is really key for making this innovation happen. And how do we see that we make any progress? For that, we need data. And also, where do we need to make progress? And how good are we with making progress? That is the last piece in the puzzle, that's data. So here, everything comes together. And that's really a very useful diagram for me. You need the policy to enforce some movement. You need the innovation to actually make progress. You're fueling this with investments, and then you can gather the data to check your progress, but also to see what's next. And if there's one book that's really good on this topic, especially when it comes to the role of technology, then it's this one from our old open source nemesis, Bill Gates. He also transformed himself quite a bit, I have to admit. And it's really a good book. It shows, on one hand, of course, how necessary it is that we improve the situation. He's focusing on climate because he says that's the basis for everything. That's also an interesting change of mind, because his foundation actually is very much focusing more on the social aspects. But in this book, he's really focusing on climate change and which role technology plays in this game. And that's really really the one book I would advise to read to get a good understanding of the topic here. For the insurance industry, There is already some movement in terms of policies. We have given here a short overview of how the topic is advancing. So it definitely will be coming. It's not yet fully in place. Also in the banking industry, it's not yet fully in place. Nevertheless, the European Central Bank held first regulatory discussions with the institutions they oversee. I think it was last December that they had the first talks. So the topic is here, the topic is coming, and it requires a lot of change, and that also means it requires a lot of opportunity for startups to actually help facilitate the change with clever solutions. So let's look at the different roles that insurers can take. We have here the insurance in the center of the graphics, and then we see a few stakeholders in insurance companies are interacting with. There are, of course, the corporate customers where insurance companies are managing risks, and we will later see that there's a big correlation between sustainability and risk. One is driving the other. There's also a lot of investment happening, direct investments, traditional investments, but also investments in startups. So insurance companies can use these investments to actually facilitate change. Insurance companies can gain a competitive advantage. We will later see that sustainable investments are actually better performing. So they can gain an advantage there, but also in terms of their attractiveness as a business partner, they can gain advantage over their competition. Or vice versa, if insurance companies don't move in that direction, they will actually lose attractiveness in the market. And then insurance companies can, of course, use their partner ecosystem to actually mitigate the risks. So when you manage the risk, you put up a financial model and then put out your policy and your pricing. But at the end, of course, insurance companies do not want to manage the claims. They actually want to avoid the actual damage. That's also one of the changes that we see, that technology advances. We can avoid more and more damages, and that is something we now do not only have to do for health insurances, where people are encouraged to have a healthier lifestyle, or with connected car insurances, where people are encouraged to have a more defensive driving style, but also in using our planet. We need to behave in a different way, and that is where insurance companies, through partners and ecosystems, can help to mitigate the risk. Very important topic also is, of course, the private customer. Private customer will put more and more focus on sustainability. So in the future here stands 3 to 5 years, there will be a majority of customers be conscious about whether their investments are geared towards sustainability or not, and will choose their providers based on that. And especially in the new banks, I think in the panel there's also tomorrow, they put this at the core of their brand, as I understand, and I believe it will be more and more important driver when it comes to acquiring new customers. Now let's look a little bit on the side of the investments. So what I've brought here is some ETFs that invest in a traditional way, and that's the blue line you can see in different regions. And there's also a sustainable investment here in German, unfortunately, Nachhaltig. And this green line shows the sustainable investment, and you see that it is more profitable than the traditional investments. A little bit lagging maybe in the emerging markets, but there now the growth is even better. So you see that it's not only about doing a good thing to the environment, to the society, but it's also doing a good thing to your money if you focus on sustainable investments. So where are the insurance companies here? So they are not really leading the pack. Interestingly enough, they are further advanced than the banks with their investments in sustainable assets. However, the institutional investment investors and asset managers are much more advanced. So they're still, yeah, you can still catch up in the insurance industry. And I believe it's definitely paying off. But I hear the challenges, of course, there's still some difficulty in having enough transparency on the investments, getting the right data, having no clear classifications. The EU put out a so-called taxonomy, where they actually provide KPIs and definition of KPIs on what sustainability really needs. Means this, of course, needs to be implemented in a way that you can also track through non-financial reporting whether the loan, for example, is actually contributing to improvements in energy consumption or whatever the goal was. So it's also interesting from a technology point of view, and I believe that is really a very interesting area for startups, is to see how can we bridge the gap between the financial and the non-financial data. How can we correlate that? How can we align the data with the taxonomy that's coming? It's probably not as simple if then else. There's definitely some AI involved into that. So building these data-fueled financial products is I believe, a very interesting challenge. Yeah, and so what insurances here need to do in terms of investing is, first of all, determine the status quo. Where are they? What does the portfolio look like? How can they optimize the portfolio? And also, how can they do direct impact investments? Are there some areas where they do not go through companies, but directly invest into certain projects that then help to make a systemic change and really help to change the game in certain areas for certain topics. And we will later see a kind of a heat map in my presentation where you can pick and choose areas for such impact investments. Last but not least, there is the role of the risk manager. Here it gets a little bit complex. It's a very interesting table that a task force for the PSI task force, that's the Principles for Sustainable Insurance, that they put out. And I would like to explain the mechanics of this diagram and then later deep into it a little bit more. But it's definitely a good read if you want to identify areas of interest for any innovations that you may have in mind when it comes to sustainable insurance. So this matrix works in a way that here you again find the important letters ESG. So you find certain criteria. They are broken down to certain themes. So like climate change belongs to environment, biodiversity, and so forth. And with each theme, there are associated a number of risks. And these risks are then further broken down to mitigation actions and good practices. So what can you actually do to mitigate these risks? And then you also see the impact broken down to economic sector. That's really interesting. So if you are an insurer and your customer is in such and such sector, then either there is a very high risk for your business, either because maybe the economy will be impacted. So when you look at coal, no one is really investing into coal. So having all your clients in the coal industry is maybe not a good idea. But also there can be agriculture, and even though agriculture, of course, is important for the future, there may still be a big impact due to the climate change or reduced biodiversity. And that then leads to that you should focus on these mitigations. And last but not least, the various risks and mitigations are then also linked to the principles like the UN Sustainable Development Goals. That's the goals you saw that, that also NCT has subscribed to, but they're also the PSI, that's the Principles for Sustainable Insurance that we will look at the end of this presentation, that are also addressing these areas. Yeah, and on the next slides, you see, and actually the quality here is not very well. It, it looked better when I created it. But I think I have explained how this scheme works. And the topics they're looking at is climate change, is environmental degradation, unsustainable practices like fishing beyond the limitations, and also animal welfare. And then on the second page, you find the social topics, especially the human rights like child labor, etc., human trafficking. So that all falls under that slavery topic that that I used to motivate this talk at the beginning. And last but not least, there is governance. Here also the right structures are needed, like for example, illegal and unethical payments is a big issue that needs to be addressed in this stage. So what are the challenges and the tasks for the sustainable risk manager? Again, it's all about data. So how can you quantify these risks? What kind of data points do you need to include? How can it turn these risks into pricing for your policies? How can you improve your risk management models on that? How are the numbers changing also over the course of time? And of course, all these problems are really difficult to be directly addressed. So it's not in the hands of the insurance company to abolish child labor with one investment, but it requires good coordinated action and with partners, networks, NGOs, and so forth. And that's actually what also leads to the tasks that the insurance companies can take away. So first of all, they probably need to update their scenario analysis and stress tests and reverse stress tests and whatnot, and to be more dynamic as the things are changing more rapidly, especially when you look at natural disasters, for example. And they also need to expand the provisioning of environmental and socioeconomic data. I think especially reinsurance companies have great data available. And I believe that the future also lies in the principle of data diplomacy, so that you're actually exchanging data for around common goals. And that I would also see is something where technology can really help, not only to distribute the data or to collect the data, but also then to refine the data, to understand the data, and to drive some action out of the data. And of course, insurances and especially also insurtechs should look at the principles for sustainable insurance, which kind of guide the way on how insurance companies will advance in the area of sustainability. And that leads to the conclusion from my side. So as one part of my conclusion, I have brought with me these principles I have already referred to a few times. So first principle says that we will embed in our decision-making environmental, social, and governance issues relevant to our insurance business. That's a nice second part of the sentence, because as you've seen the metrics, actually everything is relevant for the insurances because it directly drives the risks. The insurances will work together with clients and business partners to raise awareness, but also to manage the risk. That's of course due to the fact that things are not so easy to change. So we need to find the right allies and create the right power systems and power plays to actually enforce the change. And in that sense, the insurances will also work together with governments, regulators, and other key stakeholders to promote the action that goes basically in the same direction. And number four, also very important, the insurance companies will demonstrate their accountability and transparency. I think that may also go a little bit in the direction of the next talk, that is then also on how can we make a good marketing message out of that, because when you are transparent and you're actually showing good progress in that area, then you should also benefit from that with a good standing in the market and with a high appreciation also from the consumers, which are your customers. Last slide from my side is back to the original model on how a sustainable economy works, what it takes to make the impact. And what I have done here is that around this puzzle here with the four areas, the policy that is actually triggering the change, the innovation that's enabling the change, financing which is fueling the change, and data which is at the end showing the impact. I have listed a few ideas where I believe there are some great business ideas behind these topics. We are pursuing ourselves. So for example, with aerial intelligence, we do quite some work in the AI space to evaluate aerial images and for example, to see at scale changes in the environment, the seagrass population, for example, or whether certain agricultural areas are used as they should be used to avoid overuse of certain areas, but also, for example, to provide a CSR engagement platform for companies where you can promote your sustainable programs and where you can also motivate employees to contribute, maybe also even in their spare time. There's a platform we have that you can deploy in your environment. And in that sense, there are a few cool topics. Also, when you look at quantum computing, we are currently doing quite a bit of research in the area of adiabatic quantum computing, where you can solve some NP-hard problems, so you can find better solutions to really wicked problems. And that can also help to, for example, reduce resource consumption that then again leads to more sustainable setups in your business. So that's just for inspiration. You can take that away. You can also contact me on such topics. I'm always interested in discussing this in a one-to-one session. If you have an idea, whether we can link it up with something we are doing, we are very open for any kind of collaboration. And with that, I say domo arigato. Thanks for your attention so far. And I have not seen the chat, so maybe I can stop sharing and we also look at the chat if there are any questions.
Yeah, we have some questions. I think one question is, how can insurance companies incentivize their customers to be more environmentally and socially responsible? Are there any good examples? We can do that with the health insurance, as you mentioned, to behave more healthy, or for the car insurance to also drive more healthy. But are there other examples how insurance companies can incentivize their customers to maybe be more socially responsible and so on?
Yeah, I would say especially in the B2B space, there is definitely something you can do, because being more environmentally responsible also reduces risks when it comes to damage that insurances then might have to stand in for. Also when it comes to worker safety, if you have better safety measures in place, then of course the premium you pay for your policy goes down. So at the end, how can you incentivize customers? Of course, with money. And how can insurance companies reduce money? They can reduce money when they reduce the risk. And I think technology gives you a really good lever to actually reduce the risk and to prevent the damage. That can be, for example, by using wearables that monitor worker safety. It's also a case we had implemented with a smart shirt that we were monitoring workers. And all that can contribute to less work-related accidents or health issues that then lead to less cost.
So cheaper policies, basically. And as you also mentioned, the financial data, so that you combine financial data and sustainable data, are there already some good providers, or is that just emerging that you can really?
No, there are very established. There are very established rating agencies actually for sustainability. I would have to dig out the names. I did some research, but already forgot. But there definitely are data providers, and there are even rating agencies. So what you know is like Standard & Poor's, maybe is a popular name for financial rating. But there are similar companies that. Do ratings on sustainability.
Yeah, I've heard from a investment guru that it's really hard to invest in sustainable companies because they basically also don't know if they're really sustainable, because maybe they there's a lack in monitoring of the supply chains and so on. It's really,
and that is actually why the taxonomy of the EU is so important, to really have a common yardstick to measure sustainability, to really understand what are the KPIs, how do we measure them, how do we report them, and based on that you can then better compare. When it comes to supply chain, here little advertisement again. we have a nice blockchain based solution, for example, where we can track a supply chain across multiple organizations. We are, for example, using this also for phishing, so that you can actually track where tuna is coming from, whether it's coming from the right areas where you're actually allowed to fish tuna and not coming from other areas that are then overfished. That's also an area where technology, again, can help to provide this transparency and to provide better data. That then needs to be aligned with this taxonomy. That's for sure.
Very good. And what are the, maybe last question, just pretty quick. What was the question actually? What are the projects you are offering in that sustainable space to customers that are currently in demand? Because I think IT providers that can help a lot with that transformation, and there will be some typical projects maybe that come up in that space. So what is currently in demand from insurance companies?
Definitely what we also see here in how to monitor supply chain to avoid slavery. Everything that helps to monitor supply chains across organizations. And that's not only for slavery, that's also agriculture policies or fishing policies, all these kind of policies that you have, and to actually track that and to have a visibility of who contributed what in that supply chain, that's definitely one. We are also looking at the whole topic of carbon trading, even though it's in the press for a very long time. There's still a need to have some good platforms for carbon trading, for the actual carbon trading. That's also an area we are working. Mm-hmm. And of course, everything around ESG reporting is very important, because the big companies, of course, do non-financial reporting already. They actually have to do it also when they are publicly listed. But the famous German Mittelstand, is lagging behind in that topic. However, they will be the ones who are very much involved in that innovation piece, and they actually need the money from the banks to fuel their transformation. The big players can anyway go directly to the money markets and put out their own financial instruments, but the Mittelstand actually needs this, and for them to provide a solution that takes all the data from all the data lakes and SAP systems and whatnot, and creates an ESG report which is aligned with the taxonomy of the EU. I think is a key instrument and maybe a killer application for a good fintech.
Very good.
If Lena needs a new idea, then maybe she can do something in the area of ESG reporting, because I believe linking this ESG reporting then with the actual financial product and making this a dynamic digital thing, that's a really interesting area.
Cool. Then let's head over maybe to Lena and also to the banking space. Lena, what is our next speaker? And the next meetup will be in September 16th, because we thought everybody is sick of online meetings and might want to enjoy the summer and having fun, drinking some beer, making love, and then we see each other back in September. So that's from my side.